restoration.
Welcome. We're saying a very big thank you to our sponsors, BZ4G. Busy 4G. How many of you have it now? How many of you have your busy MiFi?
Let me.
You have one. So you spent only 159 Ghana cedis, right? What do you do with it? Instagram.
Browse.
I tag you pictures.
You tag me pictures. I've been seeing your pictures, but now if you tag me, you have to pay me, because you'll be giving me work. I hope you're enjoying it, right? It's making it so easy for you now. And especially those of you at school who have to do a lot of research, it helps you, doesn't it? 159. 4 months. Free. A big thank you going out to Yas Washing Powder and Yas Sanitary Pad, La Palm Royal Beach Hotel, to my crunchiest breakfast choice, Hooch Corn and Choco Flakes. Thank you very much. Thank you to GTP, and you can see me wearing my beautiful GTP fabric. And you have to support GTP, because this year they're 50 years, and we should all be proud enough to say we contributed to Dick's success story. Thank you going out to Ophelia of ABS Collection. Thank you very much, Ophelia, for this beautiful outfit that you designed. To Roji One, Kokompe Eye Clinic, Jemima, thank you for my hair. To Nanama of She Sparkles, Nana, thank you so much. I feel like a natural girl. You're doing an amazing job. To all of you studio audience, you're amazing. Thank you so much for always making sure you come to support. If you're watching this at home, you are our biggest and our heaviest sponsor, because without you, we will not be getting the ratings that we do all the time. To my production company, M-Clan Media, thank you so much. If I should ask you the definition of woman, I'm sure most of us will keep struggling to find our words. Even though we see women every day, even though we could be women ourselves, I am sure we still do not know the definition of the word woman. Today, I have a wonderful woman who would be breaking it down for us to know who we are as women and what our roles are. Please, let's welcome our guest for today, Prophetess Zipora Crowning Crown. Hello, mommy. Let me help you up.
Wow, thank you.
Kindly have a seat.
Thank you.
How are you doing today?
Fine, great.
And I'm sure, I'm wonderful. I'm sure today a lot of women are really like on the edge, because they would want to find themselves. Yeah. Who is a woman?
Woman from scriptural perspective, because woman is not a social evolution. She's a creature of God. So we define her from God's perspective. And the Bible says a woman is she that was taken from the man. Because when God brought the woman, Adam said, "This is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman." So I'm defining it in that context. A woman is she that was taken from the man.
And when you bring it to our social circles, let's say for someone who does not read a Bible, who would you define a woman to be?
I'd say a woman is a female man.
I like that.
The female version of man. Humans are male and female. Mm-hmm. The female is called a woman, mm-hmm. or the one who carries the womb. The man with the womb. It's a contracted word.
Okay.
The womb man. So woman.
Wow. Never thought of it.
The one who carries the womb. You see? So the man with the womb. It means that the name denotes her role. Mm-hmm. You see? She carries the womb. She shall be called woman. The womb man.
What is the role of a woman?
The role of a woman, society has tried to define women as homekeepers. I suppose that idea came because she bears children. Mm-hmm. She's a mother. So I suppose that role may have evolved out of her mothering role. But I, as a minister to women, I define the role according to what God says. If we know the purpose of something, then we can tell what that thing is supposed to do.
Yeah.
So if from God's perspective, God says she's supposed to be what? A help meet. a companion comparable to the man. Because when he created Adam, he said, it is not good that he should be alone. I will make a help suitable, comparable for him. And so he made the woman. So, but from God's perspective, she's the one who fully complements man and then makes good the state of a man. That's why the Bible says, never says he who finds a husband finds a good thing. The Bible says twice, he who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord. So you notice in Genesis 1 that when God creates, he fills any of the medium. He created the land. He said he appraised everything. It's good. He creates the skies. He appraises it. He says it's good. He creates, you know, light, all those things. So you see Genesis, every is like a colophon. Every section of narrative ends with, behold, it was good. But when it comes to the man, God creates him, appraises him, and said, it's not good that he should be alone. So sometimes we get the feeling that the woman is an afterthought. No, she's not. God's purpose for creating the woman was to add fullness, to complement the man's existence. And then, of course, Adam prophetically said she's the woman, also to perpetuate the creation. So God looks at woman naturally and also prophetically. At the prophetic level, the woman is actually supposed to be a barometer, a measure of what is happening in society. And at the natural level, a mother, a companion. Are you getting me? And a social mover. She's the prime influencer of lives. That's a woman for you. The prime influencer of life. That's a prophetic one.
I'm sure most women are watching us and they not know this. Most women are watching us and they feel, I'm in a corner because our society does not really push women like that.
Yes, it's because the society, like I said, has prescribed only one home, a role, homekeeping, like she gives birth. And it's not even, the concept is not dignified. It's like she's just a breeder, like how they have a fine goat that will breed for them. You see, and it's an insult to God because the Bible said God created human beings, male and female. You see, so the woman is as much the image and likeness of God as the man.
As the man.
You see, so God, a lot of jibes we make at women or at people, we feel, oh, it's just between me and them, but it's always at God. God feels personally insulted. That's why Jesus said, even if you give water to a least of this, you gave it to me.
Me.
God feels, when it has to do with man, God feels, takes it personal. Do you understand? So a lot of women don't even realize that what society prescribes to them is not their full capacity in Christ. They don't realize that that's not the only role God assigned for them. God has a wide idea. And let me tell you, Satan knew, the devil knows. If we will not know, we refuse to know and we bury our head, the devil knows. Why, ask yourself, why is it that when the devil went to the Garden of Eden, he didn't go to the man, he went to the woman?
The woman.
He knew.
She had influence.
He knew that her prime role in God's creation is to be an influence. So he knows that once he gets the woman, he's finished. And he heard God say, it is not good that the man should be alone. And he heard God say that it is the woman's creation that will make solve that problem. And when she came, he heard God say that, behold, everything is perfect. So he knows that if he gets the woman, he's gotten the whole creation. So you hear people saying, oh, it's because the woman went to exaggerate facts. She didn't submit to the man's authority. She went walking about the garden. If you look at the wording of the text, they said she took of the fruit and gave to her husband who was with her. So the man was there. So it's not like, okay, rebellion is a sin. She was not yet a sinner. So how can she be sinning before she became a sinner? Number two, people say she was exaggerating. God only said they shouldn't eat, and she said they shouldn't even touch as mm-hmm. well. So she exaggerated facts. We all know exaggeration is a lie. Mm-hmm. So how can she be lying before she became a sinner?
Yeah.
It doesn't make sense. Mm-hmm. Satan knew that God's primary role for the woman is to mold and shape nations, mm-hmm. peoples, character through her influence. Mm-hmm. And Satan knows that the influence works greater than the decrees and the commands and laws. You can make laws for the nation to be there on paper. Mm-hmm. You can take it through the finest process. It can be the best set of laws. Mm-hmm. If there's no one to implement it, the law will remain on paper. Mm-hmm. It will not translate mm-hmm. into the lives of people. And that's the woman's role. She translates things into lives. So you give her sperms, mm-hmm. she translates it into human being. Okay. You give her money, she translates it into food on the table. Do you understand? Mm-hmm.
That is deep.
Wow. That's woman. And until we are ready to accept God's purpose and definition of women, we'll be going around in circles. We'll be going on in circles.
What is submission when it comes to the woman? Because most men have issues that women are not submissive, women are too aggressive, women try to do everything. Is it in the nature of women to be that way, to try to be in control and do things?
It depends on what we call submission.
Mm-hmm. What is submission?
We have the Bible sense of submission. Number one, I just want to clarify that God never told the man to make the woman submit. It's her work. The man's work too is to what? Love.
Love.
Now, submission is you, are you getting me? Mm-hmm. Making yourself secondary or subordinate to somebody deliberately. It doesn't, you may not be inferior. Let's take it like a managing director and his deputy, mm-hmm. a CEO. That CEO deliberately takes orders. It doesn't mean that he has a lower IQ mm-hmm. or he's a lower human being than, mm-hmm. do you understand?
Yeah.
It's a deliberate, voluntary thing mm-hmm. because of his position so that there will be order and ordered hierarchy in the mm-hmm. organization. It's the same idea God had in mind, because God knows that there will be times that there will be a stalemate, there will be a clash, society goes through. Mm-hmm. So he says, when you, the woman, see yourself as secondary mm-hmm. to the man, and you, the man, don't abuse the position mm-hmm. because essentially you are not better than her. Are you getting me? Mm-hmm. It's something I've imposed on her, a role I've imposed. So you to reciprocate with love. Mm-hmm. Because it's very easy to submit to someone who loves you. Are you getting it? Mm-hmm. Why do people go to war and take up arms against tyrant regimes, dictatorial regimes? Nations fight them. Do you understand? Mm-hmm. So why are people surprised when women push against wicked government in the home?
I like that.
It's all
dictatorial government in the home.
It's only government at a smaller level. Mm-hmm. So the way they go to the street with placards, if you don't take care, you translate it. I'm not advocating that. Nobody should think mm-hmm. I'm a feminist with radical ideas. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying that everybody feels injustice keenly. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't matter whether it's in the home or in government.
In government. And would you say the society have denied us certain rights as women? And if the society has, what are some of these rights?
Society, what society will give you depends on the level, the mental maturity, mm-hmm. or the kind of ideas that society has about you. Mm-hmm. Are you getting it? Mm-hmm. If a society thinks that teachers are not very important, they don't value education, they wouldn't make conditions of teachers a priority. Mm-hmm. In the same way, if the society thinks that, women are just, a wave of hand, mm-hmm. then you have it coming to you as a woman. So it depends on the value the society places on the woman. For example, there are societies in the past that they literally deified woman. Look mm-hmm. at Ephesus in the Bible, Diana of Ephesus. Mm-hmm. The whole city rioted just because somebody came to preach that she wasn't a god.
In another society, that would be ridiculous.
Yeah.
I mean, oh, goddess, I beg your pardon. So it depends on the level of thinking of that society. Now, when a society is properly conditioned from God's perspective, that society will look at women as first, as the image and likeness of God. Two, as God's workmanship created in Christ Jesus unto good works. And three, the society will see the woman as what? A mother, the one who bears God's ideas, who bears God's generations. Do you understand? Look at Mary in the Magnificat, Luke 2. She said, "For behold, from henceforth, all generations shall call me blessed." So it depends on where your society's mentality is at per season. But when you see a place that women are being sidelined, marginalized, treated as just chattel, property, then you know that that society is not Christian. It is Christian.
And that society needs help.
It needs help.
So who will an ideal woman be?
Ideal woman. The ideal woman is a woman who knows who she is. An ideal woman is a woman who does not define her worth or who she is by societal norms. She defines her, who she is, her worth, and her through what the scriptures say. Because let's face it, it's God who created humans. So if you really want the correct and accurate information, it's better to go to his manual, which is the Bible. Are you getting it? And it's because we have rebelled against God. That's why we have all these tailspin. Society is in a tailspin. We have chosen our own ways. We want to believe what we want to believe. We don't want to listen to God, particularly the Bible. Oh, it's somebody's. We have a woman, but that is where there is truth. That's where there is peace. So a woman is one who knows that she's God's, God brought her. Number one, to produce subsequent generations to fulfill God's agenda for the earth. And she does that through influencing the character and nature of the society. That's her role. She's also a what? So that's her motherly role. She's also an intercessor. Somebody who carries the issues of society, starting with her own family, to the broader society before God. She's an intercessor. Then she's a helper. Helper of what? A man. And that relationship she has to contract. It's not general. Until you marry, you activate that through marriage. So you don't expect that every woman is a helper. The wife is the woman you marry is your helper. Are you getting me? So society, we need to reshape the thinking of society towards women. And you find a lot of people say, oh, women like, they brought this upon themselves. They did this. You see, they don't understand the nature of the soul of a human being. When you oppress people, when you maltreat people, when you put people down over a long period of time, the people begin to see themselves through your treatment of them. It's what do they call it? The tyranny of what? The familiar. Restoration.
And for most of us, we encounter men who think women are a little bit too much. Even at your workplace, if a woman happens to be the boss, the men are intimidated and they try to find all sort of malicious means to get the woman in trouble. Sometimes they could be your friends at school. If you're too intelligent, they don't understand why a woman has to be intelligent. And some men can make you feel it's a mistake you're born a woman. It's your fault you came as a woman. It's your fault you're smart.
And you're supposed to be dumb as a woman.
Also eats up some women. And I know some women who were very smart, who could have done great things, but they felt it was a mistake. They had been created that way. How do you deal with such situations?
It comes here back again to the society. See, when you have children, boys and girls playing, they are not conscious of male, female. So you see that they flow.
They flow.
And the girls will flow with the boys boys don't have problem with girls topping the class or vice versa. Mm-hmm. They play together. Mm-hmm. Till they begin to be self-conscious and notice society. So they begin to copy the attitude of the society, the environment, and they also pass it on. Do you see? Mm-hmm. So we see a woman as inferior. And what caused all these things? There are three things about women that if we clarify and get correct from the Bible's perspective, societies will begin, if they accept it, they'll begin to change their perception of women. And we'll have these things sort of resolving themselves as it were. Mm-hmm. Now, there are three situations about women that govern every society's belief about women. Number one, that the woman was created second to the man. Mm-hmm. Number two, that she was created with material from the man's side. Number three, that she was the one tempted. Mm-hmm. Number four, they think God cursed the woman. So you see, anything that people feel they are justified in doing, it's very difficult to get them to stop.
To stop.
So you see tradition, wherever you go in the world, you see the same pattern. Mm-hmm. It's not only to Africa, everywhere.
Not at all.
It's a universal thing. Mm-hmm. So you ask yourself, how did it come about? Number one, why was the woman created after the man, not at the same time or before? It has created a lot of cultural and social perception about women being... The Bible is clear that the woman was created... The creation of the man and the woman was typical and prophetic of things to come. Number one, the creation of male and female. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians 15:45 and Romans 5:14 that Adam was a type of the Christ, he who is to come.
Yeah.
So as God is bringing Adam, he has in mind Christ. And the woman is typical of what? The redeemed or the church under the new covenant or of humanity in general. So you see the Bible using the feminine to refer to cities, peoples,
nations.
It's not accidental. So Adam symbolized Christ. The woman also symbolized the redeemed or the... That's why even Christ calls the church his bride. Do you understand?
Mm-hmm.
So these are the prophetic platforms on which God created. So Adam, if he was symbolic of Christ, and Colossians 1:15 tells us that Christ is the firstborn of creation, then of a necessity, he must be created first. And then Christ must also come, give his life for the church. So Adam came, God put him into the deep sleep of death, as it were. Opened up his side, took material, and created the woman and brought her as a bride. Listen. The same way, in the same way, Christ came, was in the deep sleep of death on the cross. A soldier pierced his side. Why didn't he? He could have pierced his tummy or his chest to make sure he's dead. Pierced his side, and the church was born from the blood and water that flowed. You see? So we don't understand that God had a blueprint. The blueprint was looking far into the future. So whilst he was creating the male and the female, those were the things that he was looking at. It was not to show who is inferior, who is better, or who is of greater value. Look, if you pay the same price for two items, they may have different functions. This chair may be worth the price of maybe, let's say, that painting on the wall. They are serving different functions, but they have the same value. So Christ died for both male and female. It's the same price God paid for both the male and the female. The Holy Spirit, there was no female Holy Spirit.
Or male Holy Spirit.
Or male Holy Spirit. The same Spirit of God came on both male and female. And besides, God did not even despise coming through a woman's womb. Hey, human beings, a big man will say, oh, bah, oh. But God did not despise the virgin's womb. So let's look at what God is saying. The wise people have said that if you don't understand what God is saying, observe what he is doing. So God had a blueprint. The woman came in the office of humanity or Christ, or the church, or the redeemed. So you see God saying to Israel, I want to teach them a lesson that it's important that they should be faithful to me. Mm-hmm. So he tells Hosea, I'm going to use your life as my canvas to paint this picture for Israel. Go and marry a harlot woman. And then he tells Israel, you see, this is you and this is me. Mm-hmm. God calls Israel his wife. In Isaiah 54 verse 5, he said, for your maker is your husband. So you see, the she, the woman, the idea of woman prophetically, it's not what society has made it. That's not what woman is supposed to be. The idea of woman before God was that of the redeemed. And mind you, God took the bone from the side to show partnership. Mm-hmm. That's why he said, yoking animals is side by side. Mm-hmm. He said, do not be misyoked with unbelievers. So it's a yoking. Are you getting it? Mm-hmm. Side by side. If we stand side by side, it denotes what? Equality, partnership, oneness, isn't it? So these are the ideas God was giving us by taking material from the side.
From the side.
And then they don't understand why, hey, God molded the man. Oh, it was great sculpture. And then when he came to the woman, spare ribs. I've heard some people say spare ribs. You see, and that day I asked them, 1 pound of meat plus 1 pound of dust, which one will be more expensive? They kept quiet. You see, but what was God trying to tell us? God was just trying to paint the picture of marriage to us. Marriage. Mm-hmm. If God had not taken material from the man's body to create the woman, there would have been no physical attraction between male and female. That thing was just... And you see, because that attraction is very physical, God had to put laws on it. Mm-hmm. Do you understand? Yeah. So a man sees a woman's physical body and he goes bananas. Do you see? And the woman is, look, his rippling muscles and his macho and things doesn't move her one bit. Mm-hmm. Are you getting it? It's your pocket, you know?
Because I'm laughing.
Because it's not so much because she's greedy for money. She's looking at money as a medium of security.
Looking at the future.
So God took material from the man's body to create the woman, just to create a bond of one flesh. Mm-hmm. And that bond of one flesh is activated through sex. But God says contract it, because the consequences are wild. Mm-hmm. It's more than atomic bomb. So he says what you do is that you contract a relationship of responsibility, care, love, respect, and it's called marriage. So by taking material from the woman's body to create the
man's body
to create the woman, God was just telling us that I'm creating a bond of one flesh, and it's called marriage. Mm-hmm. And that's why sexuality is merely physical. Mm-hmm. Excuse me to say, some women think that if a man sleeps with you, it means he loves you. Mm-hmm. For man, it's just a natural drive. Because it's a physical bond. Mm-hmm. So God had to impose laws on it. You can't do it unless there's commitment. Mm-hmm. You can't do it because you need to pay a price. And that price Adam paid, which was the piercing of his side. Christ too, to get the church as a bride, had to pay the same price. Mm-hmm. Because he came to replace Adam, the first Adam. Mm-hmm. Now, if you go and sleep with a woman you have not paid dowry, that price for you, you are a thief.
How many thieves are in this room? And how many thieves are watching us at home? Julo!
Are you the woman too? Unfortunately, you actually aided and abetted the thief to come and steal your father's house.
You see, police has to arrest a lot of people in town.
So that's why the Bible says if the thing happened in the city, they should kill both of them. They should stone both of them, because the woman should have shouted. They said if it happens in the bush, they should kill only the man. They should give the woman the benefit of the doubt that maybe she shouted, there was no one to rescue her. Oh, okay. That's why when the court brought the woman caught in adultery to Christ, Moses' law said we should stone such people. Mm-hmm. Jesus didn't mind them. Because that's not the law.
They're justified.
They said we caught them in the very act. So where is the man? It takes two to tango now, don't it? So where is the man that she was caught in the very act with? So you see, even Israel, God's people who had the laws, had degenerated in their perception of women to that level. And Christ had to correct it. He said, oh, if it's a matter of you are punishing her sin, not that you are following the law, then the one who has never sinned before, you be witness against her by casting the first stone as the law requires. And the Bible says, beginning with the elders. I suppose the elders, because they've had a long habit of sinning, you know.
Yeah.
The older. So they left. Are you getting me? So we need to renew, transform our societies by renewing our mind. And when women turn in on themselves, don't think that, oh, they hate themselves. No, it's because you have done damage. And the damage cannot be corrected overnight. They don't have any other example by which to rate themselves except what you have told them. So if you want to correct it, correct the social norms first and then encourage them to see themselves from another angle. But if you are telling them, preaching at them, see yourself differently, and yet you are treating them the old way, you confuse them. It's like telling a child, oh, I love you, and then you are cruel to the child. The child is confused.
Is this what love is supposed to be?
Yeah. So these are some of the things we need to note, that God had a blueprint. He took he created the man first to show the office of the Christ is above that of what? Humanity. Two, it's also meant to show that the man is the one who has to separate first. He has to come out first. So he said, man shall leave what? His father and his mother, and then be joined to his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. So the man comes first, and later the woman. So you see, nature instinctively teaches us that the man must be older in a marriage. These are just the canvases God was painting for us, and then we have turned it into something else.
But we also have situations where some women take undue advantage. They meet a man or a partner who is very caring, who is very loving, is very soft, because the person might know the values of a woman. Then the woman begins to get to be a tigress at home. The woman tries to control the man. How do you deal with such women?
It's human nature. It's human. At the office, if you have a boss who is lenient, a supervisor who is lenient, people steal stationery, they come to work late. Am I talking to someone here?
Yes.
It's human nature.
So, madam should not say
anything.
Do you
see, when people begin to show love, a man begins to show a woman love, or a husband is kind and does the right thing, the attitude is that, the notion is that I'm doing you a favor. You're not doing her a favor. You are doing yourself a favor. The Bible says no one hates his own body, but he cares for it. So if you care for your body and your body is becoming fat and round, and then you are feeling a bit lazy, do you not stop caring for your body because your body is misbehaving? So why this? As a mother, especially if a woman becomes rich, she becomes arrogant. Have you seen any human being who is rich, who is not arrogant before? It takes grace. Because money has the nature of making you grow wings. It's normal to human nature. It's not a matter of being a woman or not. If you give somebody the chance, the person always, even if it's a boss, if you are too, you know, obsequious, subservient, hey, yes, director, this thing, with time the person will just walk over you. It's human nature. But you see, because we still have the notion that I'm doing you a favor by loving you, other men don't love their wives, so if I am loving you, I'm doing you a favor. So if you see any negative thing, I told you, then she goes. As for women, when you are kind to them, they will ride over you. Be kind to a child and be extra nice and loving. The child becomes pampered and spoiled. Sit down. Come sit down.
Eat.
I won't
eat.
I don't like. Bring it. I'm bimbi. Isn't it true?
It's true.
But if you terrorize that child, as soon as you are coming, you haven't said sit down. He's sitting down. If that's what you want. But you see, that child will grow up into a dummy. He has no self-confidence, nothing. You see, when we are beginning to love women, they will take advantage of it because it's natural. It's a natural progression. Be patient. And the Bible says, train her, change her by instruction of words. God says, take the word of God to train. It's not fisticuffs or threats. You see, even in boxing, they don't put heavyweight and lightweight together. and God gave you muscles for you to bear the brunt of. You have now turned the thing into heavyweight versus lightweight. Mm-hmm. You are not a champion. Nobody is going to give you a title for that kind of bout.
No one will give you a title.
You're just fighting yourself.
That one is wrong, my. Restoration.
How do we correct that societal stigma of women are low, women are this, women are that?
We teach
We're trying to build it. How do we teach it?
We teach it. The church has to take the lead. There are three society institutions that influence lives. Mm-hmm. The church, the school, the church, the school, the home. If these three take it up, you'll be amazed that within 40 years, everything has changed, because that's one generation. Mm-hmm. But if we all pay lip service, we are doing this show here, we've said so much, people will just be tickled. Most people will be tickled. Oh, that was a nice show. That Stacy lady, did you notice her makeup? She's lovely. And some man will be looking at your feet. She has lovely feet. Some lady will say, I want some of that shoe. You see, all that you are doing is lost on the person because they don't see the use. Mm-hmm. So we as a people have to have the will and decide that we won't change.
Yeah.
You see, and don't expect the men to pioneer it. Look, let's face it. If you have a system that gives you advantage, that benefits you, would you readily allow the system to go?
Mm-mm.
So why do you expect that the man will get up one day and say, oh, the way we are doing women is not good, oh, let's change.
They have become politicians.
It's a dream. Only politicians do that. You know, they are poly tricksters. So it's all just, it's poly, plenty tricks. It's just to get you, you know, inclined in a certain way towards them. And I don't blame them. Human beings are hard to convince. Mm-hmm. You see, but we also have to have a will to change. Do you understand? Mm-hmm. And let me tell you, the only way you can get true change is through conversion, Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus is the answer for the problems of man. There's that song, you remember it? Jesus is the answer for the world today. So we can have religion.
Mm-hmm.
Religion doesn't cause heart change.
Mm-hmm.
It only imposes norms. Mm-hmm. Ablutions, rules, regulations. Are you getting it? It doesn't change the heart of man, but Christ does. Do we want to change and have society as God conceived it? It's Christ.
Mm-hmm.
There is no other solution except Christ. For he says, I am the way, the truth,
and the light,
and the life. No one can change society. You may cause some cosmetic change,
mm-hmm.
but you see, if you want lasting change, then you have to change the heart.
Mm-hmm.
Because the Bible says, guard your heart carefully, because out of it are the issues of life.
Mm-hmm.
So until you change the heart, you can't have permanent change.
Mm-hmm.
Education can give you some modifications, mm-hmm. and you know,
and
you learn. You know, you see, the fisherman will shout at his wife, mm-hmm. You see, but that's education will make people. Him say, education will make him do the same thing in a refined way. And nicer way. It won't stop him doing it. It will just make him do it in a less dramatic way. So whilst the other one is hopping about, my boy, education will say, you are a bitch.
Can you say that again? What will education say?
You see, nicely, do you understand?
Mm-hmm.
But it's the same dagger,
mm-hmm.
the same dagger.
Mm-hmm.
One threw it from a distance. Quite, our him here, the other one choked you direct. It's the same effect. You are wounded.
And I like the attitude when she said it. And I'm sure he might be even reading a newspaper or having a juice in the garden, and he will say that to
you. Yes. So we are joking. We are just wasting our time. The earlier we recognize that true change comes through Christ, and we all embrace. We've tried so many philosophies and dogmas.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't we, as a society, we have tried ideologies, we have tried education. I'm not saying that Christianity and education are mutually exclusive. Mm-hmm. No. We've tried many things. Why don't we try Christ? because nations have tried them and they had golden eras. Then they started being lazy and they are fading down. They are going down the drain. So let's give Jesus a chance as a nation, as Ghana. How can we say we are secular? What is secularity? When we say we are secular, it means we don't have a heart, because every human being is supposed to worship.
Mm-hmm. And we fall short.
We fall short.
I am sure you've healed a lot of homes with what you have shared, and you have to come back again, mommy. You have to come back again, because it's such a huge education that we all need. What you are teaching us today, we don't even get them at church. The church is not even talking about it like you are. And I think that as a society, irrespective of where we are, being it in schools, homes, churches, mosques, everywhere, we have to teach women to love themselves so that they can love the society. How can someone love you if you cannot love yourself? Mm-hmm. It's the way I treat myself that would compel you to treat me better. If you come and I don't wear shoes, my clothes are tattered, I'm sure you don't even look at me. But when I dress beautifully, you come, I'm always smiling, you would want to be my friend. It's the same way with love. So women, we have heard Auntie, let's try our best. From the beginning, it's going to be difficult, because when you've eaten meat for so long and suddenly they are telling you to eat salad, it's difficult. But I'm sure we can still start from somewhere and we would make the next generation a better one.
Amen.
Before I let go of you, I have something little
from
our sponsors to say thank you and keep on with this drive. Mm. And when I met you, I was so happy because my team and I, we've started a campaign called The Love Project.
Wow.
And we're going around schools. We're going to teach young women to learn to love themselves, believe in themselves, so that the next generation will be a generation of women who know their worth, who know their values, who would be able to behave as queens to their kings.
Amen.
So thank you so
much.
You're
welcome.
I'm saying a very big thank you to our sponsors, Busy4G, and I'm sure those of you watching us from across the world, you're having your stream fine. Those of us in Ghana who are always missing the episodes on TV, I'm sure we'll not have issues now because of Busy4G, because we give you the right stream. There are no cuts. It's a straight viewing, and I know you're all enjoying it. And for just 159 Ghana cedis, you can have your Busy MyFi and enjoy all our 4 baskets of freebies. So please, wherever you are, especially those of you in school, most of you are complaining about data. Forget complaining about data. Just save money, buy it, and you will be sorted for the rest of the semester or the term. Big thank you to Yas Washing Powder and Yas Sanitary Pad, to Hooch Corn and Choco Flakes, to Special Ice Mineral Water and Special Drinks, to GTP. Thank you very much for my fabric. Ophelia of ABS Collection, thank you for this beautiful design. Roji One Studio at Darkoman Kokompe Eye Clinic, Jemima, thank you for my hair. To Nanama of She Sparkles, thank you, Nanama, for my makeup. And I should say my crew, thank you. Lately, you've been doing amazing. To our production company, M-Clan, thank you very much. If you want M-Clan to do anything for you, so far as movies are concerned, so far as radio commercials are concerned, if you want to score sound for your movie, you can get in touch with M-Clan at Fanofa Street, Kokomlemle, and they are sure to give you a fantastic job. That's the number on your screen. Get in touch with them now. If you're a movie director and you're waiting to edit your movie, anything, get in touch with them, and your work is definitely going to win some awards, because we are good. We know our worth. We are good. So give us a call now. I'm also saying a very big thank you to all of you lovely studio audience. You make it amazing and beautiful every time, and I really appreciate all of you. Get in touch with us on our social media platforms: Facebook, Restoration with Stacy; on Instagram, Restoration with Stacy; on Twitter, it's Restoration with Stacy. If you want to follow me, you can follow me on Facebook, Stacy Amwatin; Instagram, Stacy Amwatin GH; and Twitter, Stacy Amwatin. It has been amazing. Always do remember, you can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. We'll see you next week.
Come to the end of the tunnel. I see a bright light shining.